Random House Audio presents The Purpose of Power, How We Come Together When We Fall Apart. This is the author, Alicia Garza. For Mumsy. Introduction. 7 years ago, I started the Black Lives Matter Global Network with my sisters Patrice Cullors and Opal Tometi. BLM went from a hashtag to a series of pages on social media platforms like Facebook and Twitter to a global network. The movement has generated the highest number of protests since the last major period of civil rights. When I started writing this book, that's what I thought it would be about, the story of Black Lives Matter, its origin, and most profound lessons. The funny thing is, when I sat down to write, that's not what came out. The first paragraphs were about my mother and how she trained my eyes to see the world. The opening words turned into a story about my own personal journey, words about lessons I've learned from more than 20 years of organizing and building movements, words that I know I wanted and needed to read when I started doing this work so many years ago, words that honestly I need right now. It's my deepest wish that the words that follow are the ones you need to hear right now too. Even though I'd been an organizer for more than 10 years when Black Lives Matter began, it was the first time I'd been part of something that garnered so much attention. Being catapulted from a local organizer who worked in national coalitions to the international spotlight was unexpected. The OGs in my life would probably say that Black Lives Matter grew me up, but that's not quite true. My experience with BLM toughened my skin and softened my heart. It confirmed things I knew but couldn't express, clarified and sharpened my values, and taught me how to recommit to work that broke my heart every day. BLM accelerated my education in movement building, but it was the decade of organizing prior to Black Lives Matter that grew me up. My parents used to run an antiques business, so I grew up learning about history through people and the objects they made. For instance, my favorite type of porcelain is a type of satsuma ware, which has a unique glaze that makes the surface appear to be broken into millions of small pieces. The intention behind the glaze is to make the colors appear deeper and more vibrant, but it also makes the porcelain look old, a trait that implies elegance and aristocracy. As a kid, I found Satsuma porcelain beautiful because it looked like broken pieces that had fused together to make something new. I like to imagine what other lives those shards of pottery might have had if they had been put back together as something else, or what future lives awaited them. A jewelry box, a tea kettle, a dish? What might they become next? This book is the story of an organizer who comes apart and is put back together many, many times. The words contained within it, the stories that they form, are intended to add richness and depth to that larger story. It is not the story of Black Lives Matter, but it is a story that includes it, that attempts to make sense of not only where it came from, but also the possibilities that it and movements like it hold for our collective future. More than that, this book is meant to offer listeners the lessons I've learned along the way, the things I'm still learning, and what my learning may contribute in a time of profound catastrophe and limitless possibility. A time when we desperately need waves of vibrant, effective, and disruptive movements to flow all across America. I've been asked many times over the years what an ordinary person can do to build a movement from a hashtag. Though I know the question generally comes from an earnest place, I still cringe every time I am asked it. You cannot start a movement from a hashtag. Hashtags do not start movements, people do. Movements do not have official moments when they start and end, and there is never just one person who initiates them. Movements are much more like waves than they are like light switches. Waves ebb and flow, but they are perpetual. Their starting point unknown, their ending point undetermined, their direction dependent upon the conditions that surround them and the barriers that obstruct them. We inherit movements. We recommit to them over and over again, even when they break our hearts, because they are essential to our survival. When I say this, the person who asks usually seems confused. Am I keeping the secret of building movements to myself? Being too humble about my contributions? Do I just not know how it happens? No, I promise I am not keeping anything from you when I say this. I am merely attempting to be honest with you while swimming upstream against a tide of bullshit answers that snake oil salespeople have been selling us for generations. You cannot start a movement from a hashtag. Only organizing sustains movements. And anyone who cannot tell you a story of the organizing that led to a movement is not an organizer and likely didn't have much to do with the project in the first place. Movements are the story of how we come together when we've come apart. The beginning of this book is about how I came to be, the forces and people that have shaped me and shaped my environment. For me, movements are situated within what the elders would call time, place, and conditions. The political, physical, social, and economic environment, norms and customs, practices and habits of the time shape the content and character of the movement that pushes against them. To understand where each of us fits in a movement and what our best role is and can be, we must first situate ourselves inside a context that makes it make sense. For that reason, the story of how I came to be a part of social movements occupies the first part of this book. Telling this story also helps to make sense of how we got to where we are now. I then take some time to discuss the emergence of the conservative consensus in America to help listeners understand how we arrived at our present political dilemma. All stories have protagonists and antagonists, heroes and villains. The problem with using this structure to talk about how we got here is that it flattens the narrative to be about good people and bad people, rather than providing illuminating stories about how movements succeed and how they fail, stories of strategies and systems. Police do not abuse Black communities because there are good people and bad people on police forces throughout the nation. Police abuse Black communities because the system of policing was designed in a way that makes that abuse inevitable. Whether Donald Trump is a good person or a bad person has nothing to do with why he is in power. There are plenty of good people who do terrible things as part of their roles within systems. But the story of how those people, whose actions we may deplore, came to have power over our lives is a story of how a very powerful movement came together to reshape society as we know it. I also spend some time in the book talking about the emergence of Black Lives Matter and the uprising that took place in Ferguson, Missouri, in the summer of 2014, a year after Black Lives Matter was created. This part of the book is a bit of connective tissue, a pathway from how I grew up and how I started organizing to the lessons I've learned that shape how I think we can come together again when we've fallen apart. It feels important to say that the story here is not meant to be the definitive story or even the final one. Recently, I was in a staff retreat with my team at the Black Futures Lab, an organization I started in 2018 to make Black communities powerful in politics. We were discussing a breakdown in communication, trying to get to the root of how it happened, ostensibly so that we could avoid it happening again. At a certain point in the conversation, the facilitator interrupted and said, "When I was growing up, and I would get into an argument with my mother, she would say to me, 'What happens between us is half yours and half mine.' I want to encourage you all to take that approach here. How would the story of what happened change if you all acknowledged that what happened between you is half yours and half theirs?" I found that to be a helpful intervention, and it's one that I offer to contextualize the content of these chapters. I've done my best to tell the story from my perspective, where I enter, what I see as mine, and what as yours. I cannot tell the story of Ferguson, nor do I intend to. I've told the story here of my experiences and mine alone, the experiences that shape me and continue to shape me. I can only speak of what I know. There are lots of stories out in the world about what happened in Ferguson and who started Black Lives Matter. What I can say unequivocally is that Patrice, Opal, and I set things in motion, but there are many leaders in this movement, some of whom have risen to prominence. The stories told here are intended to be honest about the ways that making celebrities out of people in our...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.